Good morning. Welcome to the Ward Scott Files, News Radio 980 and live on the internet, newsradio.com, wardscottfiles.com. Click listen live or listen on your smartphone with a tune-in app. We're everywhere. Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. Ward Scott, your humble narrator who's never wrong.
Never.
And Dr. James Bozeman, the maestro of podcasting, who is always right.
True.
And today, of course, is our ever-popular Powdered Donut Thursday. And Ed, I know that there's no sense of any time off as a mayor. So I know today you have one of your city commission meetings, and there's all sorts of things, of course, that are always, some of them constant and some of them new each day. So what have you got new and what have you got still coming back?
Well, we have it's actually going to be a pretty important meeting, especially in the afternoon, because we're taking up some GRU matters that might be of interest to some of your listeners. You know, the struggle over our rates is ongoing. You know, as I've said many times on your show, before we can reduce the rates, we got to reduce the rate pressure. So that's one of the things we're going to be looking at today. We're going to be looking at different strategies, and at, you know, our meeting starts at 1 o'clock, and we have two big items in the early afternoon: the power supply planning, and then the options and strategies for returning to competitive electric rates. Now, of course, it's interesting because we have two new commissioners, Harvey Budd and Charles Gostin, and both of them campaigned on the need to make GRU more affordable, and so, you know, sort of the back and forth that happened a year ago and even a year before that in my election and others about whether or not Gainesville GRU rates were too high seems to be completely vanquished. Everyone now agrees they're way too high and we've got to do something. So now we're going to have
that
really
was a long time coming, wasn't it?
It took a long time, and we still have... What you still have some, you know, some, what's the word, retrogrades that, they make the retrograde argument that, oh, it's not that bad, from some former commissioners.
Some naysayers.
Yeah, naysayers. Oh, it's not that bad.
Yeah.
But everyone who's in a position of responsibility for the city of Gainesville now gets it, and we agree. And so we're going to try to do something about it. And, so there should be some interesting presentations. Of course, the new GRU general manager won't begin until June 22nd. He's, you know, clearing up things back in Pennsylvania, so he'll be coming down. But I know he's up to date on things, so he should be bringing in. I mean, he's going to hit the ground ready to move, but we're already going to start the conversation now about what we can do to make our rates more competitive. And, you know, it's not just those who won the elections who believe that, and of course you'd have to extrapolate to say that it's by the people in our community that also agree, because they're the ones who voted on those who are now in office. But even our you know, our bond rating agencies like Fitch's, Standard & Poor's, and Moody's, I participated in the bond discussions last year, and we've maintained a pretty healthy bond rating, which is good. But they all put it in their reports that they're concerned about the high rates and that we've got to make them more competitive. I mean, that's what they talk about, which is interesting because usually a bond rating agency, their main thing is they just want to know you'll pay the bills, you'll pay your debt. And so usually it comes along the lines of, are you willing to raise rates if necessary to pay your debt obligations? And they mention that in here, and they say, yes, we feel confident that GRU will do what it takes to meet its debt obligations. But it adds that, you know, GRU does need to look at this rate structure and try to make it more competitive. We're also going to talk about things, I think, about, and especially at the June 10th. On June 10th, we have a strategic planning retreat. But I think we'll also talk about today, which will be our tiered rate system. We've had three tiers for electric, residential, and I've always been against it. I think it's very much a family unfriendly rate structure. You know, if you live in if you're a single person who lives in a little apartment, you can, you know, you'll have a very low rate, and so subsequently you'll have a low bill. But if you're a family of four, family of five, and you live in a single family home, your bill, because you're going to use more energy, is not only the total dollar is going to be more, but the rate you're paying on it's going to be substantially more. And which seems very unfair, because if you have four or five people under a roof per person, you're actually using less energy than the person living in the apartment. But the apartment dweller gets the break and you get the higher rate.
Well, I always thought the three-tier system was hocus pocus. I just, you know, it didn't seem to be a very straight-on way to deal with the problem. It was shifting the cost and all these other things that occur when you're trying to hide the real brutality of this miscalculation. The other thing I think the people are looking for, and I think right now they think they have it, and I hope it stays, and even including the new manager, is there's nobody now coming to this issue with a hidden agenda. You see, that's what we have suffered, low these many years, Ed. We've had a hidden agenda infecting, if you will, the actual analysis of the utility. It's been used politically. That's the problem.
It was absolutely a political tool.
Absolutely, a political tool.
We had politicians say they want to get Gainesville on the map. We want to be number one, you know, on something. And so this became the tool to do it. I remember some of the people, like I remember Rob Brinkman back when, and he's with the Sierra Club, and he's been a big activist along this line. I remember many years ago in city commissioner, he used to come to city commission, and he would say, we need to pay higher bills so people know what they're doing to the environment. And we had statements like that. Well, you know, this became the tool. I mean, it substantially increased our rates. We're paying a whole lot more now. And, you know, people are feeling the pain. And to me, that's not government's job, is not to make citizens feel pain. You know, it's not turn them into misers. That's not our job, you know. And
well, particularly when they have no choice and from whom they can buy the product. Now, some of us do in the, you know, I'm on Clay, and the city of Alachua wisely gives us for options. But James, he's on GRU. He's in the actual city. I'm in the countryside. So you don't have a lot of choice. Even I don't think I could switch anybody else. I'm just fortunate to have Clay. And that's the other onerous part of all this, is that it's a monopoly. And if you have people with political agendas using this thing as a way to fleece the public, and the public can't push back, that's what elections are all about. The only thing that's happened I see now that has changed this is getting you elected, getting some new commissioners there, getting these people up there who are on the Kool-Aid off the dais so that we can have a conversation. And it's not to say we still don't have people on the left on the commission, which is fine. Yes, but I don't sense that they're as strongly eat up with, if you will, the hidden agenda as the previous people. Is that your take?
Yeah. There's a big difference between someone who's ideologically driven and others who just have sort of a leftward lean. I mean, this is the university towns. We're talking about our first segment regarding athletics, and I'd say in terms of politics, we're going to be a left-of-center town for the most part. But I'd emphasize the word center. You'd still have people who know how to tack toward the center to get things done. And those are people you can work with. The ones that are just as hard left as possible, no matter what, that's what we had, but we don't have it now. And I think that's a good thing.
That's great. Mayor Ed Braddy with the City of Gainesville Mayor on Powder Donut Thursday. He's just devoured one donut. He's moving on to the second. We're right on schedule. It is 7:29 on the Ward Scott Files with James Bozeman on News Radio 980. Welcome back to the Ward Scott Files on News Radio 980 at 7:34 on Thursday, June 4th. It's Powder Donut Thursday. And, you know, we have got a caller who has been off touring the world, James.
On a world tour, yeah.
On a world tour. And has come back, I think, probably having partaken of wonderful meals and great restaurants all over the place. Is that right, Debbie? Welcome to the Ward Scott Files.
Oh, thank you. Wonderful to hear you guys again. But I tell you, I almost had ended up coming back all alone. I was afraid Ernesto was going to jail.
Uh-oh.
If we were at you got to be careful over there. We were at the train station. They allow you to bring picnic lunches on the train, and I'd made some wonderful sandwiches, French bread, tarragon mustard. Well, he insisted on putting a gyro in the machine to get potato chips. I said, no, we don't want potato chips with this. But he did it anyway, and it got stuck. And he's beating on the machine trying to get his potato chips out. And I thought for sure with all the security they were going to arrest him, but we got through okay. But that was the only rough spot that we encountered.
Beating on the potato chip machine.
I can't believe it. You know, we didn't need potato chips, but that's a man thing. I'm not getting into it, wasting the time. I just wanted to say, you know, Ed, you're right. We do have a lot to celebrate. I know sports are really exciting, but City Hall, we do have a lot to celebrate with now finally having a majority on the commission that I feel is really going to look out for the best interest of the citizens. But I just, you know, want to, you know, I don't mean to be a Debbie Downer, but I just think we need to be careful.
Debbie
it took
Downer.
A heck of a lot of work to get there. Mm-hmm. It was not easy. Mm-hmm. It took a heck of a lot of work, and we can lose it in a blink. So I think the citizens need to stay engaged. I'm very hopeful, mm-hmm. and I'm very happy that we are where we are. But I just say stay engaged because I don't trust certain elements out in our community. But thank you for everything, and it's good to be home.
Thank you, Debbie, and we'll
good
have
you back.
We'll have a word with Nesto. We'll James has a calming effect on people, so we'll have him hang out with James for a while.
That's pretty funny, though.
That'll teach you.
I don't think James could get up the.
I like potato chips,
but I don't think James could get up the energy to beat on a machine.
No. I have people to do that for me. So.
But, you know, Debbie's right. We, you know, just a few victories at the polls does not mean you've had the change. It just means now you have the momentum to have change. So, you know, we're looking forward to, I think, having some very meaningful now conversations. You know, it's interesting. Last year, I think we did a pretty good job with the commission that we had. And the year before that, my first year was pretty tough. We had some very ideologically strident commissioners, former Commissioner Thomas Hawkins and former Commissioner Susan Botcher. And we still have, you know, when Debbie mentioned the majority, I want to be clear, we do not have a conservative majority or a Republican majority. It's still a majority Democrat commission. But I think what she's referring to is you have some pragmatic folks up there, some folks that have some business experience, some real world experience like that, and they want to get things done, you know, and they're sensitive to the affordability issue. And they don't, they haven't built their careers on, you know, sort of these, what you were talking about earlier, these ideas of how to use, you know, government assets as political tools, essentially, to change behavior. They just want to say, you know, we have utilities to provide. How can we do it safely? How can we do it efficiently? And how can we do it affordably?
You know,
the majority we have.
You had a really good phrase there. They want to use those people to change behavior. You see, that's not their job. You know, the job fundamentally is, first of all, provide the services essential to providing a civilized community. Mm-hmm. And then from there, if you have money left over, of course, then you prioritize that and you decide which is, I think recreation is an important thing and all that sort of business. But this thing about engineering human behavior, which is always the hidden agenda, as you know, in these traffic plans and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah. You know. And by the way, today we're also awarding the bid on our 8th Avenue. And I know some people may say, well, we went back to four lanes, but what else is, you know, you said you're going to do more. We are going to do more. As promised, we're going to build a cycle track off the road, so it's safer adjacent to the sidewalk. Rebuild the sidewalk, and then of course we're going to resurface 8th Avenue. So we're doing the bid on that today too. But you're right about that, and that to me has always sort of bothered me when I do the debates, when I get into debates with the progressive left and all of that is that those who want to change behavior. Think about that word. What that means is that these people are former city leaders and others who aspire to take these positions. What that really means, Ward, is that they're driving around here, looking around at our community, and they're deeply disappointed with how you've chosen to live your life. That's the people who want that. I mean, that is their thinking, and they're seeking your consent to take office to change how you live. They look around and they're deeply disappointed that we drive too much, that we use too much energy and all that. And so they want to use the city's assets to change your behavior. And I have a different approach, and it is, you know, we want to facilitate people's quality of life. We want, you know, if you want to do things, we're going to do it here. If it imposes an external cost, we're going to assign the cost, but we're not going to tell you you can't do it, basically. And that's a difference between sort of that prescriptive mindset versus a facilitative one.
Yeah, one is a top-down mindset, and the other is to sort of people up. You know, you watch the people and what they need and respond to that need and try to give them the best choices, whereas the other is we'll decide the choices for you. John, I know you must be real calm today. There's nothing has you upset, is there, sir?
Well, I'm calm. I just want to add a question. I'll take his answer off the air. I want to know, now that we got a new non-majority commission on the city commission that's not affiliated with the DEC, will we ever, hopefully as soon as possible, because you never know how long to hold this majority for, have a forensic investigation and how they came up with this ridiculous contract they came up with. Now, I'm not buying these answers that was the only way to get the contract from Greco to do this, right up the way it did. This contract is totally unheard of. I want to know what was going through their head. What made them do this? Why did they do it? And I want some answers. I want no dumb shell answers that insult my intelligence. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Well, there are some people, as you know, Ed, who are still wondering about the audit.
Yeah.
Still think it's still costing us money and don't know what we're getting for it.
So. Well, I don't think the Navigant report was a perfect report, but I think it gave us a lot of stuff to work with. So before I call to spend more money on a forensic audit, you know, I think we need to work with this document. It's given us a lot, like I said, a lot of things to look at. I know our city auditor has sort of a game plan he's put together based on a lot of the findings there. And then I know that the new incoming general manager is going to sort of use that as a springboard for some action. So I want to see how that plays out. Now, if some other commissioners want to raise this as sort of the next step, you know, if this investigative audit was phase one and they want to propose a phase two, I'll certainly entertain it and put it on the agenda for discussion. But at this time, I want to work with what we got. I think we got enough to work with there to really make improvements to the utility and to try to exercise as much leverage as we can with the contract.
Well, hopefully we will be able to facilitate then some changes. I think we will under your leadership. Are we getting anywhere with
the empowerment?
I always call it enabling.
I
you
know
can't
you
do that.
I know you do.
I can do that. You can't do that.
That's right.
Not until you return to the air with us.
That's right. Once I'm out. Well, you know, we are okay. So where we last left off is the Police Benevolent Association sent me a letter concerning safety matters. And there's actually been a follow-up letter I received from our state attorney, Bill Cervone, wanting to echo those concerns because he actually has to send some of his staff, some of the assistant state attorneys on occasion out to interview witnesses and things like that. And he, too, is concerned for their safety. So I think we have elevated that conversation about safety. I know we're trying to get uniformed officer out there on a more steady basis, so that there can be someone on site. We won't have to rely on calls. And we have some recommendations that we're getting from a report we had generated on the Dignity Village, that encampment outside the area. So, you know, I think we're moving. I think we're finally trying to, look into this accountability issue. I believe it was absent. Are largely absent from the, you know, first 6 months, 8 months of the Empowerment Center, but I think we realize how serious it is. You know, folks, there are real liability issues.
Big time
for the city, for the property, and we've got to get ahead of this. So we're going to keep doing that.
Well, I have gotten involved with it as chair of the Rural Concerns, and we expressed our concern about the overflow perception of violence that has happened there at the IFAS Center on 39th and Waldo, and it's affected, as we've talked about on the air, some of the participation in some of the programs that we have there, such as the gardening programs, which heretofore have been taking place around dusk or in the evening hours. And now these people don't want to come near the place in the evening hours. So, and that doesn't get much attention. And everybody thinks, oh, all the problems are across the street, clustered right around. No, they're not. They're spread out all up and down Waldo Road, you know?
Yeah, and that's the other thing. It has the potential to spread, as you're saying. It's already spreading, and you know, we got to get a hold of this. You know, got to get on top of this. So, you know, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. I think you got some people who want to do the right thing there, and then I think, unfortunately, I think some people are still, you know, it's such a political hot potato that if you try to come in with some enforcement, some standards of, you know, performance measures and things like that, people just accuse you of just being mean to the homeless. Why do you want to be mean to the homeless? You have this whole conversation about, you know, the rules themselves being a burden. Well, the rules are designed to help them, you know, not just help the community. It's designed to help them get back on their feet. So I subscribe to the tough love approach here, and you know, hopefully other commissioners will join me in that.
Well, the progressive left used discipline as being mean. Oh, come on. Are you kidding me? The discipline gives you freedom. You know the choices you have when you have discipline. You know the framework within which you operate. Otherwise, you're just wandering around banging into doors and things without any idea what's positive and negative energy. We're going to get back with Mayor Ed Braddy of City of Gainesville, Mayor, on Powder Donut Thursday after our last break of our first hour of our two-hour Ward Scott Files show. I'm Ward Scott, your host, with Dr. Bozeman. Welcome back to Ward Scott Files. We're having a discussion here whether we should preempt you on the second hour of the show, which is going to be just a dynamite show. And I think maybe we should, James, because we've got Ed's going to talk a moment, for example, about Black Crime Task Force, and he has not heard what we're going to talk about in the second hour, which is explosive. James, let's run it.
Well, you need to set it up a little bit. So.
Okay, you want me to set it up
a little
bit?
Well, it was a special meeting of the county commission.
There was a special meeting of the county commission at 1:30 in the afternoon, ran about 3 hours, and about 2 hours and 45 minutes, something like that, into it, you hear some amazing conversation by Hutchison about penalizing deputies for arresting people for pot, which, and we're going to play this extensively in the second hour and talk about this, but Ed has not heard this. Ed was not aware of this as the mayor of Gainesville. Ed, we're going to give you a special screening. Go ahead. Have you got it set up, James?
Well, I thought it could be handled just by talking nice to the sheriff, so I did that the first year. Second year, did a little budget adjustment based on the fact that she was uncooperative. I don't know what I'm going to do this third year in the budget, but it's got to be something. What I really want is the deputies to hear, sorry you didn't get your raise because you're busting people.
Well, it's got to stop
at the street level. They got to quit busting people.
Well, there you are. We're going to run that a little bit more, and Ed has not heard that. He could not
that
even imagine that kind of conversation.
That is stunning.
Now, that is your county commissioner, okay?
Oh, my gosh.
Verbally, out loud, in a meeting of a public meeting, getting ready to go after the deputies on the street for doing their job. Now, you tell me what Black on Black Crime Task Force told you guys.
Well, I mean, the Black on Black Crime Task Force was really started many years ago. It's been going on and has great participation, and it's concerned largely with the behavior of youth, you know, and some of the crimes that take place. In an effort to, one, get kids channeled in the right direction, young men in particular channeled in the right direction, and to make communities safer. And so, and I don't have the data right in front of me, but I can just say, you know, I can say factually that when you see arrests made in, you know, predominantly minority neighborhoods, what are called minority-majority neighborhoods, the calls that go to police that result in the arrest, the calls originate from that neighborhood, from the Black neighborhoods themselves. And so it's from people who want their neighborhood to be safer. And so the idea that the deputies are just sort of rolling through neighborhoods looking for young folks to arrest is really, I think, out of line. Well, one, it's not substantiated by the facts, and two, it's really out of line to threaten their pay, essentially, or an increment in their pay based on that. And it's pretty shocking.
Right there on public record.
Just unbelievable.
And the guy said it not once, but twice, three times, four times. He said it for 1 year, 2 years. You're going to say it for 3 years. We're going to listen, audience, as James Brown called it. We're going to be running this in a very close up way. And we come back in the second hour of our 2 hour show. We're going to get after this. This is disgusting. This is disgusting. So while we had the mayor here, we thought we'd run it for him. He had not heard it. I doubt, Ed, you could even imagine it being said by a public official.
That's a conversation we won't be having at City Hall. And, I can't imagine telling our chief to, it's not going to happen. You know, it's funny. I've in the 2 years I've been mayor, to watch sort of the divergence of the two governing bodies, the city and the county, has been quite breathtaking. And I'd say unfortunate, because I'd certainly wish the county commission would start to move more in our direction, like what we're trying to do with economic development, with growth management and development services. You know, we're making real changes in City Hall. And, you know, our policing style is completely different. We have a whole Duval initiative, which is targeting relatively low-income minority-majority neighborhood. And it began with the police getting out of their cars and walking the neighborhood, meeting the people who live there, and then also meeting some of the people who are getting into trouble and explaining to them what the rules are, what the laws are, and sort of telling them, say, look, you know, here's what you can do, here's what you can't do. And it's a very intensive approach, and it's very effective. We're very proud of that. And I'd certainly encourage Commissioner Hutchinson to check out how we do things. But one of the things we don't do is we don't turn a blind eye to activity that's, you know, not legal.
Well, it's preposterous to think that you would not help the youth understand how to respect discipline and how to respect the rules. And if they want to change the rules, there's a process by which you change them. But you just don't blame those who enforce them. It's amazing. Debbie, you're back on the line, and I welcome hearing from you. Debbie, welcome to the Ward Scott Files.
Yeah, just one quick comment. I think the reason we've had the progress at the city that they don't have at the county is because we have nonpartisan elections. So I think that's what needs to change at the county for them to have the progress that we've had in the city.
Well, Debbie, that would take a whole charter amendment change, and these guys are not going to put that anything.
I know. We've started at ground zero before. Look where we've, you know, we used to have 7 DEC machine commissioners on the city that brought us the worst contract in the country, not just the city, the worst utility contract in the country. And look what we've overcome. So I'm willing to take it on. I think it can be done, and it needs to be done.
Well, it takes people like you to get these things done, Debbie. Thanks for calling in. Well, we've reached the end of our hour. Ed, I'm glad we had a chance to run that for you so you could hear it and react to it. Appreciate your candor. And I know you spoke that from the heart as well as the brain. It's always a treat to have Ed Braddy with us here, the mayor of the city of Gainesville, on Thursday. He takes time
glad
out of his
here.
Life to come by here and hang out with us for a while. And it's a wonderful hour. We appreciate you all listening. He has made off, I think, with the donuts that he came here to eat. They were very moist. We both commented on that. So I'm pleased to have pleased the mayor. It is not a bribe. No, we do not expect anything in return.
Wait a minute. Let's talk about that.
Ward Scott and the Ward Scott Files. Ed Sirenara, thanks for coming by. We'll be talking to you soon. Mayor Ed Braddy on the Ward Scott Files. And he's got to hustle off to a meeting. Today is their city commission meetings. So appreciate him taking time to come by with us.
And glad to have Debbie back.
We're glad to have Debbie back. And Debbie just made a commitment. I'm sure there are people out there who are going to be ringing her phone off the hook. For number one, they know her organizational skills.
Oh, yeah.
And secondly, I got to tell you, if you want this whole county changed, you're going to have to change it fundamentally in the structure of the way people are elected. You're not going to be able to do it under the current configuration. And it's going to take a very well-organized, a very passionate and disciplined group of people to make this change happen. And there probably are the community leaders, but Debbie will need help to get it done. It's going to take money. It's going to take a proper education of the citizenry so they understand what's at stake here. You're not going to get it from the county commissioners. It's the worst group of county commissioners we've had maybe ever. And it's we're going to talk about this in great detail here with you when we come back in a little bit. We got a couple minutes left. But basically, what you have here is what I talked about yesterday with you all was the lawful lawlessness of the people who believe that, oh, well, you know, we don't need to go through due process. We don't need to respect people's particular private property rights. We don't need to respect any or fund any of the essential skill services that we feel a community needs. We'll go out and buy land and take it off the tax rolls, even though we can't take care of it. But we won't fund public safety. This is the kind of mindset you've got governing this particular county right now. So stay tuned for this second hour. We're going to run that audio a couple times for you. It's going to blow your mind. You're not going to believe a sitting public official would say this in a public meeting. And we'll talk about it. And we want you to get involved with this and help us fight it. Ward Scott on the Ward Scott Files, News Radio 980 with James Bozeman. We'll be right back after a break. Good morning. Welcome back to the Ward Scott Files on News Radio 980 and the Internet, which you may listen to us live by going to wardscottfiles.com or newsradio.com or your smartphone tune-in app, and you may hear us even through your microwave if you're Captain Planet. We're getting ready to do a job on Captain Planet. Well, he's going to do a job on himself. We're going to devote a little time to this guy today, this joker. And we're going to not spare the truth here with you. It's pretty amazing. We gave a beginning a preamp of this to the mayor a moment ago, and he was absolutely appalled and said something like this will never, ever, ever happen in the city of Gainesville. So one of the jobs of this show is to help you understand for whom you voted, and what the issues are, and to let you hear things that you may not have been available to hear for whatever reasons because of your normal work life, and you're not one who hangs out all over the place at these political things like our concerned citizens do. I actually got this tip from a concerned citizen who called me very upset yesterday and asked me if anybody had told me yet about this conversation by Commissioner Hutchison about the sheriff's budget, and I had not heard it. And that's why we really rely on you citizens, you listeners, you people who are part of our community to give us information that we then investigate. And you help us investigate these things. There are a lot of you that we call our researchers, our research team, and you feed us information, you give us all kinds of stories that perhaps we ourselves would not have had time to know about, because you know there's only so many hours in the day, and there's so many resources that you have, and yet we have unlimited resources as long as we have you, the concerned citizens in the community, helping us get these stories. So I would not have known about this had not a very upset citizen called me, and almost shaking upset about this. So I want you to understand how serious what we're going to talk about this hour is. For all kinds of reasons, which we're going to invite you to call in and comment on. Now, today is Thursday. It is June the 4th. It is 8:10 on News Radio 980, and it's 203 days until Christmas, 523 days until the election, and 595 until hopefully we can kick Obama out of the country. That's where I would maybe go to Cuba. Gainesville 67, Ocala 66, and the Villages 68. Once again, there's about a 50% chance of rain this afternoon. You can tell that I'm a little more serious right now than I usually am. At least I think my voice is a little different because I'm very upset about this as well. We've been dealing with this guy Hutchison now for quite a while in this community. And I know that one of the things that he said once upon a time, too, but we didn't get it on the radio. It was said in the foyer of a radio station. He said, without any reservation or guilt or anything at all, he said, "Oh, our roads are not that bad here." He said, "I've been all over the world, and the roads are no worse here than they are in Chile," and started listing off these countries that he claimed he had been where the roads were no worse. It just made you do a ceiling stare. You just couldn't believe that a guy thought that way. The other thing he said to me one time outside of a forum was, you know, "I really enjoy hoodwinking governments, government regulations, and outfoxing them and getting things done in ways that don't submit themselves to the traditional ways that you get things done in government." So this is what we're dealing with. Now, we know, just to set the stage for you, that there is a history of animosity between this county commission and the sheriff. In fact, that's the way the Ward Scott files started. When Commissioner Baird called me on one of her very first meetings about 10:30 at night, because I had helped her, as you know, some of you know, get elected to the county commission. And she and I were and still are very close. And she called me and she said, "You won't believe what happened today." And I said, "What happened?" She said, "They've already voted." I said, "Who's already voted?" She said, "The county commission has already voted." I said, "Voted on what?" She said, "The sheriff's budget." I said, "You got to be kidding me. The meeting, they didn't vote in the public meeting?" "Oh, no, they voted in a meeting before the meeting. And they already made their minds up." So when the sheriff got ready to go to the podium with her whole team there, her accountants and everybody who had studied the budget to present a request, Pinkison, Weathervane Lee, my buddy, was the chair at that time. And he says, "Well, we don't need to hear it. We've already made up our minds." And incredulous, the sheriff says, "How could you do that? There's been no public discussion." And then if you listen to the audio, he starts to stumble around and backtrack and say, we just know. Well, that started the Ward Scott files, because when Commissioner Baird told me that this meeting had taken place, I was like the rest of you in this community. I just sort of trusted that what you saw was what you got. And I began to look, and we began to do public records requests, and lo and behold, we found out that they have all these meetings before the meetings, and are they legal? Are they not legal? Are they in the shade? They have all sorts of ways of protecting themselves. But the bottom line is they got together and agreed on what they were going to say publicly before they ever actually appeared publicly. They even make a deal with Rodney Long on a road tax one night that they'll get that vote done. Rodney says in the meeting before the meeting, "Hey, you know, can I get out of this meeting? Can we get this vote done in time for me to go to the Cotton Club to a dance over there?" And the commissioner, "Oh, yeah, we'll have the vote settled and everything else. So you got time to go to the Cotton Club." And James, we made him a fraud file about that. And these files are posted on the Ward Scott files. So it's really amazing. This is the way it started. So it actually started with the sheriff's budget. It actually started with Commissioner Baird telling us that a meeting had taken place already. And then they had conspired basically against the sheriff. And you can make up your mind whether it's a personal thing with the sheriff or it's law enforcement that there is an issue with. And the sheriff happens to be the person that is a symbol of all this and takes the heat for it, because the sheriff is the one, no matter who the sheriff is, who has to go to the county commission and request money for what is a basic service for the county. We know from talking with Sheriff Chris Blair in Marion County on our first Monday in the month for Sheriff's Monday that the sheriff there faces the same issue, trying to convince the commissioners that this money is essential. We need it for salaries. This is a dangerous profession. We do our best at training and finding and keeping the best people we can keep. But they still meet these opinions. So we're going to concentrate a little bit more. James and I have talked about this in the coming days of the show and give you a real history of this commission's attitude toward law enforcement. And one of the reasons we need to do this is because you know what Obama's attitude is about law enforcement. He can't stand law enforcement. And I've got to tell you, that this is political. This is the politicalization of an essential service. And essentially, the criticism is coming from the Democrats. And the Republicans have no pushback. So we will see how this plays out. We're going to take a break now. When we come back, we're going to play an audio file for you that is a recording of the comments of the commissioner known as Hutchison in a public meeting on June the 2nd. Ward Scott on the Ward Scott Files, News Radio 980 with James Bozeman. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Ward Scott Files on News Radio 980 and the Internet. It is 8:20, Thursday, June the 4th, and we're going to talk now about this special meeting on June the 2nd at 1:30 in the afternoon that was held by the Alachua County Board of County Commissioners, which you may see in its entirety or in pieces if you want to by going to the video archives on the Alachua County Board of Commissioners site. This was held to discuss a number of agenda items, but one item that was not on the agenda but nevertheless was talked about during the discussion portion of the meeting was concern by commissioners over the amount of drug busts and incarceration of people for pot. Now, this was brought up by Commissioner Hutchison. Now, I got to tell you, I have been to Amsterdam, all right? And Commissioner Hutchison on this audio compares, compares Amsterdam to Gainesville. Now, let me tell you about Amsterdam. It has live sex shops. It is a wide open, no holds barred community. I've been in the Dom Square with all the people that are hustling and bustling across Europe. I can tell you it is vastly, vastly different from Gainesville, Florida. But Hutchison nevertheless gave Amsterdam as an example where people would not be arrested if they were not selling to minors, not being a public nuisance, and not advertising and possessing fewer than 5 grams of pot. Now, where he picked Amsterdam from is, I guess he's been there. He probably sat there in the Dom Square and, you know, did whatever he did to get these opinions, and I'll let you imagine this. But he indicated in this conversation that he has, that we're going to let you listen to, that he felt this should be the policy in Alachua County. I don't know how he makes the leap. He said that officers of the law were actively looking for pot with each bust.
Well, I thought it could be handled just by talking nice to the sheriff, so I did that the first year. Second year, did the little budget adjustment based on the fact that she was uncooperative. I don't know what I'm going to do this third year in the budget, but it's got to be something. Because what I really want is the deputies to hear, sorry you didn't get your raise because you're busting people.
I don't think it's got to
stop at the street level. They got to quit busting people.
Well, he says they got to quit busting people that are actively looking for people to bust. That's what they do. And Byerly is going to chime in and suggest that Commissioner Hutchison go before the Public Safety Coordinating Committee and make a presentation. Now, Pinkerson, he's currently the liaison for this board. Hutchison discusses how he's attempted to persuade, what you just heard, what he's attempted to persuade Darnell to ease up on pot bust. He said to her, listen, I went to her nicely, and I asked her to back off on pot bust and not... You know, or I'm going to bust your budget is what I'm going to do. Well, you heard him say that, and we're going to play that again for you in a moment. He wants the deputies to hear that they do not get this now. He wants the deputies to personally hear that they did not get a raise strictly from him, and he controls the budget, and he can convince these other commissioners because they are busting people for pot. In other words, because they're doing their job. We just heard the mayor testify that these deputies are called into these communities by the very people who live in the communities that are majority-minority communities. Now, Hutchison goes on to say, this is amazing. He has this omniscient knowledge that no jury in Alachua County will convict someone on a pot bust. And then he looks at the camera. If you go look at it, he looks at the camera with that as a tip for the viewers. He says, if you get busted for pot, just ask for a jury trial. You won't get convicted. Now, in this conversation, the idea of going to the legislature where something can be legally done doesn't even cross the minds of these jokers. They don't even want to hear about it. Little mini Mike is sitting there saying, well, maybe we can go to the city and have a conversation. What in the world is wrong with that guy? What is wrong with him? Is he going to be a child forever? The entire commission, when you listen to this, didn't even consider attending the Public Safety and Coordinating Committee as a group. I mean, they don't even want to. They don't care. They don't. But now they want to get in there maybe and show solidarity, and all show up and crash the meeting, and complain about all these people being busted for pot. Are you understanding this? We're going to play the audio for you again. Are you understanding this? Commissioner Robert Carl Hutchison has tried, and he's admitted this in a public meeting, for 2 years to get the sheriff to stop making pot busts, and now he's trying to think up what he's going to threaten her with in the third year.
Well, I thought it could be handled just by talking nice to the sheriff, and so I did that the first year. Second year, we did a little budget adjustment based on the fact that she was uncooperative. I don't know what I'm going to do this third year in the budget, but it's got to be something. What I really want is the deputies to hear, sorry you didn't get your raise because you're busting people.
It's got to stop
at the street level. They got to quit busting people.
Well, there's much more of this audio. It runs about 10 minutes if you want to take a look at it. And the hours, James, do you remember the hours where we pick it up? 2 hours and...
Hour 45 minutes.
No, it's 2 hours 45
two
minutes,
hours,
not
45
1
minutes.
Hour.
Yeah.
It's 2 hours. I've got it here.
2 hours.
So here we have Hutchison saying, sorry, deputy. Sorry, deputy. Listen to this, audience. Sorry, deputy. You're not going to get a raise, although you put your life on the line every time you go out on your job. Although, each day you go out, you don't know if you'll see your family again. Although you do your job, although you are in harm's way, you're not going to get a raise because you bust too many people for pot. Now, this meeting you can listen to in its entirety on the Alachua County website at 2 hours and 45 minutes into the video. And I say you need to go hear this for yourself. It's just amazing. Just amazing. So give us a call, text me, get on the phone about this, and let the community know how you feel about it. This is Ward Scott on the Ward Scott Fires. Our call-in number is 855-275-7612. Toll free. Text me at 352-339-0337. We have Bruce on the line. First, we came in first, and then, of course, we have the sheriff calling. So, Bruce... listen, maybe I'll take the sheriff first. Let's take the sheriff first and let Bruce come in behind.
Hang on a minute.
Hold on a minute. We're going to switch it around. Are you there, Sheriff?
I think they're both there.
Are you both there, Sheriff and Bruce?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, good. You guys are on simultaneously. Now, Sheriff, I tell you, I'm dumbfounded by this. I appreciate you calling in to comment on it. And I know Bruce is former law enforcement, and he's done some research on this. So, Sheriff, what's your reaction to this?
Well, it was brought to my attention by staff the afternoon that this happened. I did not have a chance to see it until last night, and I actually watched it. I am taking this very seriously. I think it's an outrage. It's very inappropriate and out of line for any county commissioner to take the stance that they're doing. They're punishing law enforcement basically for doing their job, and we have great law enforcement in this area, and they do a tremendous job. And for Hutchison to come out and say that he's going to withhold raises based upon deputies doing their job is an absolute outrage.
Bruce, you've done some research on this, sir. I think you have looked up some statutes on this. What have you found?
Well, Ward, very seriously, first I want to say, let's keep this coverage. I don't know what to address. How people feel about pot. I want to address what people are being confronted with, which is none less than I'm alleging bribery and corruption of public officials via withholding or offering things. Florida statutes are very clear on this. And again, I'm allegedly saying there's evidence of this. I intend to approach the state attorney and ask for a legal investigation on this matter based upon the tape, because there's much more than what you've played. But anybody who wants to go to statute 828.
Hang on, Bruce, you two. We got to come up on a break. I ask you both to hang on, if you would, please, till after this break. I want to continue this thought. We do have some statute violations alleged here, and we want to get into those and what that means. We'll be right back. We have Sheriff Darnell and Bruce Nelson on the phone simultaneously. We have to take this bottom-of-the-hour break. We'll be right back on the Ward Scott Files. Welcome back to the Ward Scott Files News Radio 980. We're talking with Sheriff Sadie Darnell, and we have also on the line at the same time Bruce Nelson, who is one of the concerned citizens, about the preposterous, outrageous comments publicly made yesterday by one Robert Carl Hutchison, a county commissioner, about actually threatening to take away money from deputies who go out every day on their job and risk their lives because they make too many pot busts. And Sheriff, I was talking to Bruce, and you've done some research on what these remarks mean in terms of statutes, right, Bruce?
Yes, I have. And again, this is something that we finally determined by prosecutorial body, but all the elements seem to be there. Also, a 248, he ties raises to pot arrests for the cops, so they don't have to bust people, so their raises are in jeopardy. Well, the bribery statutes in Florida, and I'm not going to go into detail, we'll just confuse listeners. They're there under Chapter 838. But just a few points to make. It's if you offer or some attempt to influence the activities of a public servant through any process of financial gain or words they use to pecuniary is a legal term meaning money or associated with money, to not carry out their official duties and to disrupt their official duties. And definitions corruptly means with corrupt intent, means acting knowingly and dishonestly for a wrongful purpose. Public servant is any officer or employee of a state, county, municipal, or special district agency or entity. Okay, so clearly, without getting into a big legal mess, because I'm going to ask our state attorney to do that.
Well, that's interesting that you're interesting bringing that up, Bruce, because we have a texter who's already outraged about this and wants to know if the county commissioner can be removed, if the governor can remove this county commissioner. If this were indeed found to be a violation of this statute, the governor would remove this county commissioner.
Well, so I go further than that. Again, these are alleged violations. I am not one to jump the gun, as in the fraud files. I believe that the proper authorities that are legal people should make the final
right. We understand.
Nuances as to what's violated.
Sheriff?
But at this point, I'm alleging this stinks. It's wrong, and on its face, it appears to me to be bribery and corruption of public officials.
Okay, I got it. We got it. We got it, Bruce. We got it.
Constitutionally elected sheriff.
We got it, Bruce. Okay. Bruce, we got it. Well, listen, we got it. Now, Sheriff, are you there, Sheriff?
I am.
Listen,
go ahead.
We've got somebody's asked if the FDLE can be brought in. There's a bunch of legal questions coming in on me. And if you don't mind, we'll play the audio again because we got people just tuning in, don't know what we're talking about. So hang on the line. We'll play the audio again for the listeners to hear and then let you respond.
Well, I thought it could be handled just by talking nice to the sheriff. And so I did that the first year. Second year, did the little budget adjustment based on the fact that she was uncooperative. I don't know what I'm going to do this third year. In the budget, but it's got to be something. Because what I really want is the deputies to hear, sorry you didn't get your raise because you're busting people.
It's got to stop
at the street level. They got to quit busting people.
Well, Sheriff, I don't know if you can hear that tape because you're on this phone with us, but he says he's been nice to you. And now he's run out of patience, and he's going to up the ante here, and he's going to proceed with this. He's going to go after this again, year in, year out. So, what's your comment on that, please?
Well, number one, I'm not going to be influenced by somebody else's bias about what laws they agree to or against. If the laws are on the books, we are in law enforcement in this community. We're going to enforce them. And there's some discretion that can be used, and we have used our discretion where it's appropriate, but. What happened in this conversation at this meeting is clearly inappropriate. It is likely unethical, and it may be criminal. What I plan to do is proceed like I would in any situation where there's this potential for criminal action. I'm going to make a public records request, get the video, get it transcribed, follow up, have a discussion with the state attorney, and take a look at the statutes and get some consultation from the standpoint of criminal advice. I've got to look at this. I'm going to do it methodically, but it is very bothersome. It is an outrage that we've got a couple of commissioners that are jumping onto this, and it's clearly a bias against law enforcement, and they want to punish law enforcement for doing their job by withholding raises or withholding funding for the budget. And one thing I will say I need to point out is Commissioner Chestnut, the chair, was not present at the meeting, the budget meeting that morning or that afternoon. Commissioner Chestnut was not present. And so he was the only person that was not in the discussion. Commissioner Pinkinson remained very quiet during the discussion of the drug bust and the marijuana discussion. But the other commissioners had some pretty outrageous discussions.
Well, the other interesting thing about the law, correct me if I'm wrong on this, you two, but if you know of a crime or hear of an alleged crime, you're duty bound, are you not, Sheriff, to go ahead and investigate it. And I think that's what I hear you saying. You're going to pursue this. You're going to go through the channels to see if this is actually, as Bruce suggests, a violation of a statute. It certainly is unethical. I mean, come on. If you're going to sit there in a meeting that's recorded and organized and advertised, now, this was not on the agenda. That's another trick here. Just think of this, Sheriff. If it had not been for you, it had not been for Sue Baird, had not been for people like Bruce tipping me off to this story, and we would have had these meetings before the meetings, and nobody ever would have known about this. But because they're now on television, and because we've got people like Bruce bird-dogging it, he knows this happened. Now, that's why we're going to air this on the radio so that people... This will also be on the WardsGodFiles.com podcast, and we'll stay after this. We're going to do follow-up stories on this. This is not just something that started yesterday. We remember, we have a fraud file on this, as you all remember, all the way back to Byerly cooking up some intern's two-year-old numbers because the county had none. The other thing that's not on this tape, Sheriff, is they threatened to take away the jail. I don't know if you've heard the whole 10 minutes yet, but, Bruce, they threatened to take away the jail, and they threatened to just refuse people to be admitted in the jail who are there for pot bus.
It went further
right,
than
I
that.
I did watch that, and there are a number of, like I said, outrageous and very questionable statements. I plan to be methodical. I plan to go through this reasonable. I appreciate people like Bruce. He is a stand-up, credible guy in our community, and we have a number of people in our community who are concerned about the operation of our government here and who are concerned about what happens here and support law enforcement.
And, Bruce, did you not hear that?
It went further, Ward, even in not accepting people to jail. He mentions at 0256 that the leverage that could be applied would be to close a pod in the jail, denying space for such arrests. And then when he says he feels frustrated they have no leverage, Byerly responds, but we do have leverage. We control her budget. Now, people have to be sure. They are using the budget law enforcement raises and attacking our deputies to bring forth an agenda that they have no business in. The legislature sets the laws. Hutch Hutchinson's support of medical marijuana failed. I may or may not disagree with his opinions on marijuana arrests. They don't matter. What matters is he sees fit from a county commission dais as the acting chair to bring forth threats against law enforcement. We have elected Sheriff Darnell, our constitutional sheriff, and her agents, her deputies. She is the chief law enforcement officer in the county, not Hutch Hutchinson. And for him to threaten the sheriff's office and individual honorable men and women of law enforcement is why I'm so upset, because I have close ties to the law enforcement background and have been involved with it for 40 years.
Well,
this cannot stand unnoticed. It is wrong. It's way out of line. And, in fact, it borders. If not, it could be criminal. I'm going to ask for the proper entity to determine that.
Well, it sounds like they've gotten two people on their trail they should never have gotten on their trail. And actually, they have three, because they have the Ward Scott files, and they have Dr. Bozeman, and I are going to do everything we can to inform the public of this. And I appreciate the tips that our concerned citizens give us. I know you both have busy schedules. I really appreciate you calling in, Sheriff. Bruce, of course, we appreciate the heck out of your vigilance, and we're going to stay after this. We'll probably play this audio one more time after our break. It's 8:45. We've got a couple of minutes left. Sheriff, is there anything you'd like to conclude with before we go on our break?
I want to thank you for bringing attention to this. Thank Bruce for also bringing this to my attention. And his concern, it's properly placed. And, deputies, law enforcement, our community should not be punished for doing their job. And it's so ironic that this meeting happened, this discussion happened, the day after we had that severe lightning storm come through our community. We had deputies and other first responders out assisting people dealing with down trees and down lines. And then the very next day, some of our county commissioners are criticizing them and threatening them to withhold pay but based upon them doing such an exceptional job every single day, 24 hours a day.
Thank you so much for expressing yourself so candidly. This is the time to be candid. When people come up with preposterous ideas like this, if they go unchallenged, it's been our experience that if they go unchallenged, they become the norm, and we're not going to let that happen. Bruce, you got anything you want to...
Thank you very much. Leads to public corruption and duress against the official conduct of our public servants. You cannot ignore that. Politics cannot come into play. And if we can't resolve it within this community, it needs to lead the community to another prosecutorial agency. That's my opinion.
Well, thanks, Bruce, for calling in. Thanks for both you and the sheriff for calling in and participating. This is Ward Scott on the Ward Scott Files with James Bozeman. We're going to take our last break on our two-hour show. We have 10 minutes left. We come out, we'll play this audio one more time for those of you who have not yet heard it, and then we'll follow up on this in the days to come. So please stay tuned. Welcome back to Ward Scott Files, News Radio 980 and the internet, wardscottfiles.com, newsradio.com. Here with Dr. Bozeman of podcasting par excellence. We've just aired an audio for you, which we'll air one more time before we conclude our second hour. We have a caller. And Debbie, welcome back.
Okay, I'll be brief. I think your listeners need to realize how lucky we are to have a watchdog like Bruce Nelson watching over the county commission, because they're in the same position we were in 2009, where it's all DEC commissioners. And there you go. That's the diagnosis. You've got to fix. We need to make sure that we work on getting nonpartisan elections on the county, because they're ruling. And this is outrageous. This is our public safety.
Well, you're right. Here's your
have Sheriff Darnell, the most popular elected official in our community, that they're going after. It's got to stop.
Well, as you say, too, this is five boys without a homeroom mother. They have nobody there. You like that, Debbie? Five boys without a homeroom.
I love that.
Yeah, without a homeroom mother. And now that they have this new manager and this new attorney, I can tell you it's very different. The Wagner would be participating in this right now as it went on, advising them of where they were about to step in a legal pothole. This new county attorney is nowhere to be heard. And neither is the county manager. I think he's in the room. You can look at the tape. I think he's sitting on his hands in the corner. Oddly enough, the guy who runs his mouth the most in there, who's not elected, who is vastly overpaid, is Mark Sexton. And he's in there sitting right at the table with them, acting as if he is yet another commissioner. So I think, do I have another call, James?
Nonpartisan county elections, because that's the only way we're going to stop this. This is outrageous.
We'll talk about it, Debbie. Thank you very much. John, welcome back to the Ward Scott Files.
Yeah, I just want to say real quickly, I hope that Governor Scott can step in and take Hutchison to task for what he's done about, penalizing the sheriff for making pot bust. I mean, they actually need to have an FDLE investigation into the DEC. I don't care if it's a sheriff, it's not a machine, but it is a machine. They need to have an investigation into this machine that's been running the county and city commission for far too long. We finally got a city commission back, but they need to really find out, get to the bottom of this. Because I tell you what, this DEC machine has a certain constituency that they answer to. It's called the Sierra Club and Rob Brinkman. They don't give a damn about no one else, and that's gonna stop. It's gonna stop. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, if you listen to the tape, John, too, you'll hear Minnie Mike, who absolutely has no clue what he's doing, say that he was elected by black folk, therefore he was going to get involved in this because this was a place of really racial discrimination. That's what they're really doing, is playing the race card and saying these are all disproportionately black folk that are being arrested. Therefore, we're justified in shutting down the jail. We're justified in holding back deputies' raises, all the above. Little Minnie Mike jumps right in there, has no clue what he's talking about. And when the actual facts show, as the mayor testified to in the first hour, that these majority-minority communities, when the police come, are called there by the members of the communities themselves. So There's a lot. You got to watch this Hutchison. He makes stuff up as he goes. He said that septic tanks turn springs green, stream, and all that business, and that's not true. I mean, it's just crazy the stuff that comes out of his head. We're gonna. By the way, I want to take time out to really thank James for being able to put these things together. I contacted him yesterday afternoon. He went into his studio at home, and the next thing you know, we had this audio file. We plan on doing more with this. We're going to make an actual fraud file about this and run a much more extensive research into what's going on here. So, James, you tell me when we can play the audio. Do we have another caller first?
Yeah, we do.
Okay. We're going to take another caller, and we'll play the audio again. And then
we
we'll...
got Tom on the line.
Okay.
Here.
Tom, welcome to the Ward Scott File, sir.
Yeah. Morning, Ward. Thanks for
How are
taking
you?
Us. Quick question. Did this take place the day after that meeting of the DEC and the local dictators?
You know, it may have. I'd have to go back and research that, Tom. I know this took place on June 2nd. Today we're at the 4th. I have to go back and look at that day. I don't think we got time to research it right now. But what's your point about that? It's an interesting question.
Well, if it's taken day, was anybody in that meeting who is going to tell us what went on in that meeting?
Oh, I see what you're talking about. Yeah, the special meeting.
Let's get in the sunshine.
Yes, yes, yes. We'll follow up on that, Tom. By the way, I got a text coming in now. I was asking basically the same question and also wanting to know if this conversation was on the agenda. Tom, this was important. This conversation was not on the agenda. It takes place during the commissioner comments. So a human being, other than Bruce, who is, as we say, very, very vigilant in watching these people because he doesn't trust them for an inch, would never have known that this discussion, not even the sheriff would know that this discussion, so you can't defend yourself. The sheriff wouldn't even know this discussion was going to go on. And yet here these people are, sitting around, out of the public spotlight, off the agenda, making plans to dock the sheriff and the deputy's pay. And nobody knows about it. And that's why it's so important for us to have concerned citizens who stay in touch with the Warthog Command Center. Because we're open 24/7, 365, and we'll take on the projects. Hey, we don't mince the words. There's nobody sacred in all this if the story merits it. So we're going to play the audio for you again in case you haven't heard it. And we're going to expand this over the day so you can get more of the show. Go ahead.
I thought it could be handled just by talking nice to the sheriff. So I did that the first year. Second year, we did a little budget adjustment based on the fact that she was uncooperative. I don't know what I'm going to do this third year in the budget. But it's got to be something. Because what I really want is the deputies to hear, sorry you didn't get your raise because you're busting people.
I don't think it's got to stop
at the street level. They got to quit busting people.
Well, there you have it. I mean, and he said she didn't cooperate the second year. I mean, she just didn't cooperate the second year. You know, I just don't know what I'm going to do. You know, what are we going to do? She just doesn't listen to me. You know, can you imagine the ego of this character wandering around from drinking from the Lake of the Stupids, James, and standing up in his kayak and born in the wilderness. And you know, he has a history of this, by the way. We have all sorts of legal documents here that show the shenanigans that go on between and have gone on for a long time between him and the Queen Mum on these conservation boards and how these boards have been interlocking with the city commissions and how this skullduggery has infected the Environmental Protection Department to the place where we now have Chris Byrd, who basically functions at yet another county commissioner, who's not elected, who is run by the county manager, whom I think is really ineffective. I don't see anything that he's done that has amounted to anything. He's just sitting over there on his hands, scared to death of these people, I'll assure you. When you have Minnie Mike and the headmaster of the Boys Orphanage and Captain Planet all ganged up together, as they are, with Weather Vane ineffective and the Undertaker not showing up, and you've basically got three people running the entire county. And so that's where you are. You have and these names are, you know, I mean, we got to call it like it is. I mean, these guys are operating in unison. We've got a meeting that heretofore would not have been available to us because there would have been no film of this. And we don't have Chestnut even there. So Hutchison acts as the chair. It's like I say, it's five little boys without a homeroom mother. So, James, what do you want to throw in on this? Because I've said everything I could say about it for the time being.
No, it's just eye-opening. And I'm glad people are watching.
It's eye-opening, and James is a man of few words. I have to pry him out of him, but he's really good on these podcasts and behind the scenes and ordering up and getting recorded for you this material. That's how James and I began to work together, as we realized the story that we had here, and we realized how important it was that the community knew about it. So we appreciate you listening. We're sorry we have to bring this to you. We're sorry we have to be so hard on these commissioners. We like to think we're all people, members of this community. I know all these people personally. On a certain level, of course, I like all the people. I like Chuck. I even like Hutch. I mean, but I can't put up with this. Ken, all these people, we're all in this community, but we can't put up with this. We can't let this craziness run common sense. So stay tuned. We'll have more. Tomorrow we'll have Foreign Affairs Friday. Appreciate you listening to us on the News Radio 980 on the Ward Scott Files, which you also may listen to on the Internet. Have a great day.